All right, welcome back to the analysis seminar. Our speaker today is David Pérez García from Universidad Complutense de Madrid, and his title is Sobolev-type Inequalities in Position-Based Cryptography.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. With this pandemic, we are all used to meet via Zoom or other platforms, I think we can make maybe the interaction live even in that situation. Okay, so this is joint work with Marius Junge from Illinois, Alec from Complutense, and this is kind of a big part of his PhD, Carlos Palazuelos and myself, both from ICMAT. So that's the outline of the talk. Let me start, presenting what is position-based cryptography. Okay, in position-based cryptography is a way in which two agents want to communicate with themselves in a secure way, and they want to make the security be based on the GPS position. So that the credential, in order to be sure that you are talking to the person you think you are talking to, is just the GPS position. This could have interest in, current scenarios like, autonomous cars or, this world in which we live where everyone moves and essentially your mobile is your point to connection to the internet. This could be of interest and, of course, in many other scenarios. From a theoretical point of view, this is also a way to avoid one of the most important attacks, which is the man-in-the-middle attack, in which someone is in the middle of the communication of two people, and then he plays the role of Alice for Bob, Bob for Alice, and in a sense he's able to impersonate each one of them and essentially break any possible communication scheme. Nowadays, the way that this is solved is by a priori assumptions, essentially. By definition, we assume that this problem doesn't hold. But this doesn't imply that the problem is not there. And the thing is that quantum mechanics, in particular quantum cryptography, gives a possibility to make this a reality. The basic primitive for this position-based cryptography is what is called position verification. So position verification, a prover, which is this honest party here, has to convince a verifier that he is at a particular position. So that if he is at this position, he can pass the challenge, a challenge that the verifier is going to pose him. But if he is not at that position, he should fail the challenge. In this way, the verifier can be sure that he is talking to whoever is in that position. He doesn't care who is there. He only cares to be sure that he is talking to someone in this particular GPS position. Okay, and only if you are in that position, you should be able to pass the challenge. So this primitive is the basic primitive. So if one is able to implement position verification securely, then it's known that you can do any cryptographic task between verifier and prover. Okay, so that's the thing to be done. Okay, so we are going to deal with the simplest possible scenario, which is 1D position verification. And 1D means that now the verifier splits into two verifiers, that act in a coordinate way. And then the prover is in between, and they are in a line. Okay, so they are just in one line. Because this is the simplest case, and it still is not solved. How things work? So essentially, the type of challenges that the verifiers pose to the prover are the following. So the verifiers prepare some questions and send them to the prover so that they arrive at the same time at the prover. So for simplicity, let's assume that both verifiers are at exactly the same distance to the prover. And we assume, of course, an ideal scenario where the speed of light is constant and known and all these things. And then essentially, the time it takes for a signal from the verifier to the prover is just exactly proportional to the distance, okay? And this time is called, TC. So then the prover prepares an answer two answers, one for each verifier. And again, we are in the ideal scenario in which the time it takes the prover to prepare the answer is instantaneous, so there is no time. And then he sends the answers to the two verifiers. And then, of course, again, the time it takes is twice, again, the same time as before. So the total time is twice the time it takes from verifier to prover, which is twice the distance. Time is a constant, of course. And then the verifier check that the answers arrive on time, exactly that they arrive at the moment they should arrive, not later than that. And, that the answers are correct with respect to the questions asked. And of course, the notion of correct is what defines the challenge. Okay, the challenge is just defined by type of questions, type of answers, and the way to check the correctness. Okay. Good. Okay, now we have to, it's known, I will explain later why, that in a classical world, essentially, if one doesn't use quantum resources, position verification is impossible. Okay, so there is no hope. The goal is to show, the goal of this talk is to show that within quantum information, one uses quantum resources and therefore quantum cryptography, there is real hope that this position verification is possible. And we'll present, compelling evidence for that. Okay, so then I'm not assuming that you know anything about quantum information. Just believe me, you have to believe me in some statements. Okay. So now the verifiers prepare a quantum state. So a quantum state is just a unit vector in some Hilbert space. And then the Hilbert space has three parts: Hilbert space of B, which is the first verifier, Hilbert space of C, which is the second verifier, and Hilbert Hilbert space of B is the Hilbert space that the first verifier will send to the prover. Hilbert space C is the Hilbert space that the second verifier will send to the prover. And Hilbert space V is the Hilbert space that the verifiers kept for themselves. So in quantum mechanics, essentially, the particles, the systems, are represented by Hilbert spaces. So essentially, this is why I talk about the Hilbert space that is sent, the Hilbert space that is kept. This means that there is one particle represented by this Hilbert space that is moving or stays in some place. And then a quantum state is just a unit vector in this Hilbert space, this tensor product. And to simplify notations, this tensor product is just a big Hilbert space, and then we put B, C, V, meaning that there is a tensor product of the three. Okay. And then, as I said, the register V is sent from V1 to the prover, and the resistor C from V2 to the prover. So then when the prover receives the systems, he is then in position of this Hilbert space BC, which is again the tensor product of B and C. And then he applies a quantum operation. So the most general quantum operation that exists is a completely positive trace preserving map from the trace class of the Hilbert space BC into the trace class of the Hilbert space BC. Okay, when I write CPTP HVC HVC means a linear map from the trace class associated to the Hilbert space, the one that appears here, which in this case is BC, into the trace class of the Hilbert space that appears here, in this case is BC, that is linear, completely positive, and trace preserving. So preserves the trace, and completely positive means that even if I tensor it with the identity in a larger Hilbert space, the map preserves positivity. Maps semi-definite positive objects into semi-definite positive objects. It's important to say here that, as is the usual for quantum information, I will assume that all Hilbert spaces are finite dimensional. Okay, and indeed the talk is about exactly which is the scaling of the dimensions in the problem. Okay, but everything is finite dimensional. It's simply all I care is about estimates for the dimensions needed here. Okay, and I will make this clear. So there are no issues about being bounded or these things. So linear already implies bounded. Good. Okay, so that's what the prover does here. Then, after this, he implements this quantum operation, then he sends back the systems to the verifiers. Okay, B to verifier one, C to verifier two. And then, the verifiers first, again, check that the answers arrive on time, meaning the time that a signal takes to go back and forth to the exact position where the prover is supposed to be, and then correctness. Okay, and then correctness, that simply the challenge that they are posing to the prover is to implement some target operation T. And the target operation T is an operation in principle in the full Hilbert space of the problem, HVC, ACV, sorry. And then they check how far is the system they received from the prover to the target operation. I mean, they check how far this is. Okay, and if it's close enough, and of course they can tolerate some small error, then the challenge is passed. And if this is far away from what is supposed to be, the challenge is not passed. I mean, it simply fails. Good. Okay, so now that's the honest protocol. So now let's analyze what the cheaters, I mean, potential cheaters can do. So now imagine that we have two cheaters that act coordinately, and they are, of course, not in the position where they are supposed to be, but they want to convince the verifiers that they are indeed in this position. And exactly, we would like to show that this is not possible, or that, I mean, it will use a lot of resources. So which are the possible cheating strategies? So, I mean, it's important that they act coordinately. So in particular, they can send messages to each other. But the thing is that the messages that send to each other, of course, they cost time, and they must answer in time. Otherwise, the challenge will not be passed. Okay, so then imagine that the verifier sends some question, verifier one, and then the first cheater receives this here. I mean, one thing he can do, he can send, I mean, this information to the other cheater and wait until the other cheater responds to him before he answers to verifier one. But this will take a lot of time. We can see that the time it takes is the one it takes from here to here, from here to here, and back. And this is, of course, I mean, longer than the time it takes from the verifier to the prover. So in particular, this imposes a strong restriction on the amount of, on the type of communication the cheaters can implement. Okay, if we analyze, essentially, I mean, light cones, I mean, this is just time and this is distance, and this is what happens for the honest prover. So the honest prover receives both signals at the same time, and then he answers simultaneously. Let's see what the cheaters can do. So the cheaters, I mean, receive the signal at this place, okay, in the space-time. Then here, they can do the following. So they can decide to keep in their memories part of the information for a later time, and they can decide to send part of the information to the other cheater, okay? And the other can do the same. And once they are in this point of time, they answer to the corresponding verifiers, okay? If they do that, then in principle, they will pass the time constraint. I mean, they will answer in time. But this implies a strong restriction in the communication. So they can communicate to each other, but the communication must cross in there. I mean, they cannot wait until they receive a quest, I mean, an information from one cheater to answer, and then the other does something. So they must decide in advance what to communicate to the other cheater without knowing what the other cheater will communicate to him. Okay, that's the restriction. Good. And now we can see immediately why classically, essentially this position verification is impossible. I mean, if the information sent from the verifiers to the prover is classical information, it can be copied. So at this point in time, this cheater, the first cheater, copies the information received from the verifier, and he keeps a copy for himself and sent a copy to the other cheater. The other cheater does exactly the same. So at this later moment in time, they have exactly the same information that the prover would have here. So they can answer as if they were valid provers, and they would convince the verifier that they are in the right position while they are not. What's the problem with quantum mechanics? And one then understands why quantum mechanics could be the way to solve this. In quantum mechanics, states cannot be cloned. One cannot copy. So this trivial cheating strategy is no longer valid in quantum mechanics. And that's what we will exploit. Good. Okay. So now let's try to get a bit more formal. So this is the scenario of what the cheaters can do. So in quantum mechanics, in principle, they could have some additional resources, like some other states, other quantum states they share before the protocol starts. So they could have an additional Hilbert space that we call E, because of the word entanglement. You don't know to know what entanglement is. It's simply just an ancilla, an extra Hilbert space, where one part of the Hilbert space is held by Bob. Bob will be the first cheater, and the other part belongs to Charlie. See, Charlie is the second cheater. Okay, and they can start with an arbitrary state in this Hilbert space, and a state, again, as I said, is just a unit vector. So then, the first moment where they receive the Hilbert space B from the verifier 1, Hilbert space C from the verifier 2, they can do the most general quantum operation. And this, as I said, is a completely positive trace preserving map on the Hilbert space they have in that moment. So Bob, in that moment, has the Hilbert space B that was sent from the verifier, and the Hilbert space HEB that was shared, essentially, with entanglement with the other cheater. And then they can implement an arbitrary quantum, completely positive trace preserving map from these two Hilbert spaces into another two Hilbert spaces. One, which is the one of the quantum memory. So this HB2B is the Hilbert space that Bob keeps for himself. Essentially goes from B to B. And the other B2C is the Hilbert space that he sends to Charlie. Okay, Charlie, of course, does the analog thing. And this is the first operation. And the first operation I call B calligraphic, C calligraphic for Bob and Charlie. And then in the second moment in time in which they have to act, then I call the second operation with a tilde. Then Bob has to act in the following: the internal memory, HBB, that he kept for himself, plus the Hilbert space that Charlie sent to him, C to B. And then he wants to produce an element in the Hilbert space to send back to the verifier. Okay, and again, Charlie does the analog thing with a tilde. Okay, and this box is the most general cheating strategy that is allowed by quantum mechanics. Essentially, if one, of course, believes, and that's the hypothesis, that the cheaters must behave according to the laws of quantum mechanics, this is the most general strategy they can do. Okay, which is just, again, a pair of completely positive maps. This circle means some transmission of information, and then another pair of completely positive trace preserving maps. And they start with some initial entangled state, with some initial state in the Hilbert space HE, which is this tensor, has this tensor product structure. Okay, so this type of strategies in which the communication, as I said, crossing there, is called simultaneous two-way communication model, and this is called S2W, okay? And that's kind of the communication allowed by the cheaters. That the cheaters must respect, because they must respect quantum mechanics. Okay, so let's analyze what is known so far about this. So around 2010, couple of years before this framework was presented, and then around that year, these were most of the, there was a lot of excitement about this, because there was one clear scenario which was of real interest in which quantum mechanics could do something that classically is impossible. So there was a lot of excitement, and essentially most results are from that age, let's say like 10 years ago. So the first result is, and it's quite surprising, is that for any target operation on the common Hilbert space BC, there is a way to simulate this with this model of communication, this S2W. So essentially, for any operation that you want to do simultaneously on the Hilbert space of B and C, the tensor product of the two, this can be achieved to arbitrary small error with a protocol of this form. Okay. So essentially, this shows that at an information theoretical level, secure quantum position verification is impossible. However, in these ways to simulate arbitrary target operations, the cheater need to use an enormous amount of entanglement. So this means that the dimension they need to share in this extra Hilbert space they have is exponentially large in the dimension of the Hilbert space that is sent by the verifiers. And indeed, there is a huge gap between the upper and lower bounds needed to break any position verification scheme. So it's known that there are some position verification challenges for which one needs at least the same dimension in the Hilbert, I mean, in this extra Hilbert space, in this entanglement Hilbert space, with respect to the dimension of BC. But the best upper bound is exponential in this dimension. So our goal is to show that indeed there are some challenges for which an exponential dimension is needed. And this will imply that for all practical purposes, position verification is possible, because this will, I mean, in order to break those schemes, the cheater should have exponentially larger resources than they are supposed to have. Essentially, I mean, and this is essentially this is secure for all practical purposes. Okay, when the resources needed for the by the cheaters are exponential in the resources needed by the honest party, then I mean this is what one expects for essentially any secure cryptographic setup. Okay, so essentially the goal is to show that indeed there are some challenges for which the exponential dimension is needed, because it would imply that position verification is secure. Okay. And the goal of this talk is to go to prove things in this direction. I mean, okay, good. Okay, so let's go now to the results. Okay, so now we have to make some comments. Okay, so first comment is that we care now here to understand the size of the quantum resources. And then in order to single out them, and also in order to help us designing the game or the challenge, we will assume that every classical resource is free. Essentially, the cheaters can have arbitrary large classical memory. They can communicate arbitrary large classical information. And indeed, we will also allow the verifiers to send and receive arbitrary large classical communication to the prover. Okay, so essentially, classical resources are for free. Okay, and also we do not consider computational complexity considerations. In a cryptographic scenario, one always wants that the honest party needs to implement only operations that can be done efficiently in time. And we will forget about this issue. Okay. Indeed, we will only focus on the dimension of the quantum resources. So the plan is we want to construct a particular challenge that we call G-RAT, and RAT is because there will be some Rademacher random variables going on, and prove lower bounds for the entanglement dimension required in attacks to that challenge. Okay, that's the goal. Okay. So let's construct first the challenge. Okay, now the challenge will be a bit asymmetric. Okay, let's go slowly. So verifier 2 will send to the prover classical information. So in particular, n square bits of information, and the bits, instead of being ones or zeros, are plus or minus ones. So this epsilon is just a string of n square bits. Okay, and this is sent to the prover. Verifier 1 will prepare a particular state in this Hilbert space. And just I will be using this usual notation in quantum information, but it's very easy. This ij is simply stands for the tensor product of the computational of the canonical basis vectors. So ei, again, I am assuming that the Hilbert space are finite dimensional. So in particular, there is just canonical basis. And I call EI to the elements in the canonical basis of the Hilbert space in B, I mean, EJ canonical basis computational, of the Hilbert in C, and this ij is just the tensor product of these two objects. Okay. Okay, so the state that is prepared is this one. Okay, with this notation. Good. And now what the prover is asked to do is they asked a unitary transformation that acts diagonally on the that is diagonal on the canonical basis. So essentially that in the element ij of the canonical basis of BC acts diagonally, I mean just simply multiplied by epsilon ij, because these epsilons are plus minus ones. This is a unitary matrix, so a diagonal unitary matrix. Okay, so then the prover has to do something, okay, and then the verifier check that the answers arrive in time. And what this prover is asked to do is just apply this unitary, which in quantum mechanics, what happens is that I thought I have written this. This notation psi stands for the projector, rank one projector onto the vector psi. Okay, this is a state, an element in the trace class. And then it's simply just a pure state associated to psi, I mean the rank one projector on psi. And then the prover is asked to apply is just a conjugation of identity in V tensor, this unitary on systems BC. I mean, and it's just simply conjugating by this object. Okay, this is the adjoint action. Okay, this dagger is just the transpose conjugate. So this is the adjoint action by identity in the Hilbert space that is kept by the verifiers, and this diagonal unitary on the space that is sent to the prover. Okay, that's what is done. And one can check trivially that this conjugating by a unitary is completely positive and trace preserving, so this is something that can be done. Good. Here is where I explain this. Sorry, this notation is this projector onto psi, orthogonal projector onto psi. So then the way that the verifier check that the challenge has been passed is by doing a quantum measurement. Okay, a quantum measurement, that's another thing that happens in quantum mechanics, is defined by a couple of two semi-definite positive operators that add up to the identity. And then one of them will be associated to the outcome the challenge has been passed, and the other associated to the outcome the challenge was failed. And then this operator associated to the pass outcome is simply the state that is supposed to be constructed by the prover. Okay, and the other is just identity minus it, because they have to add up to the identity. And then in quantum mechanics, the probability of success is just the trace of this operator with respect to the state that was created by the prover. Okay, so that's just what quantum mechanics says. This is the expectation, I mean, the expected value of getting the outcome pass. So therefore, we call the value achieved by a strategy to this expectation value, which is the expectation value in the questions. And the questions are supposed to be asked, so these bit strings are supposed to be asked with uniform probability. So this bit string is generated by verifier 2 with uniform probability and then sent to the prover. And this expectation value is with respect to this uniform probability. And this is the probability of passing the test. So this value is nothing but the probability of passing the challenge given by this probability by a given strategy followed by whoever, the honest player or the cheaters, I mean, someone. Okay, so again, now the strategies of the cheating players will be just strategies of this particular form that we commented before. And we will give a name, this sigma S to W, I mean this simultaneous two-way communication, to the set of strategies that the cheaters can do, the most general strategies that they can do, which is this type of strategies. And therefore, we are interested in the optimal strategy the cheaters can do. Okay? And this is this value here. And how this is related to the amount of entanglement, so the dimension they are allowed to have. Okay? How these things are connected. That's the goal. And now we can state the main result first in an informal way. And the main result we have is the following. So if the cheating strategy depends on the bit string in a sufficiently regular way, and this will mean that if I modify slightly the bit string, the cheating strategy should be modified also slightly, then the entanglement needed to pass the challenge is exponential in n. And that's exactly what we want. Because if we go back to the challenge, the dimension of the Hilbert spaces, let's say the dimension of the quantum part of the challenge is n. Is n. Note that the dimension of the classical part is exponential in n. But we are assuming that classical resources are free. So the quantum part has dimension n, okay. N squared, but I mean polynomial in n. And then we are claiming that if the cheating strategies are sufficiently regular, they need exponential amount of entanglement. And this goes in the direction to show that position verification is secure. So essentially, if cheaters can break position verification, so far, either they need exponential resources, and therefore, okay, they cannot do that because exponential is forbidden. Or they need to cook up very irregular strategies, so very sophisticated strategies that depends in a very irregular way with the bit string they receive. That's the result. Okay, in order to make it formal, there's a technique which is called Stein spring dilation, which allows to purify quantum operation. Essentially, any completely positive trace preserving map can be purified, can be seen as a partial trace, some operation, on a larger system, and then the operation to go to the larger system is just an isometry, Hilbert space isometry. And the nice thing is that now, with this, we just work at the level of Hilbert spaces. So essentially, the most general thing that the first cheater can do is a pair of isometries, V and V tilde. Again, the tilde is for the second operation, the non-tilde for the first operation, and the second cheater W tilde. And now they are just isometries on Hilbert spaces. And also they share some initial state, psi. Okay, so now a cheating strategy is specified if we give a couple of isometries for the first cheater, a couple of isometries for the second cheater, and a shared entangled state they start the protocol with. Okay, and this, okay, these are the Hilbert spaces where things act. They are the same as before. And we will note by K the maximal dimension of the quantum systems manipulated in a strategy. Okay, so K is an upper bound to the dimensions of the entangled systems and also the dimension of the quantum memory and the dimension of the quantum system they communicate. So K bounds the quantum resources they need. Classical, they have free resources. They can use as many as they want. And we would like to show that K must be exponential in N, where N is the dimension of the quantum system associated to the challenge, the questions and answers. And now we can make the result formal. And that's the formal result. So if we are given some epsilon, we define epsilon bar ij as the same bit string, but in position ij, I flip the bit. If I had a plus one, now it's a minus one. If I had a minus one, now it's a plus one. And now this is the regularity notion. So we want to show that for the second round, everything has tildes, the type of operations that the cheaters will do with respect to the operations they will do if just one bit is flipped, and I measure this in operator norm, this is controlled. So this is not too large. Okay? And the way this is controlled is by, some power law decay, 1 over n to the alpha. So if this regularity bound is fulfilled, then k, the quantum dimension needed, scales exponentially with n. Okay, that's the claim, that's the result. So a couple of observations. First is, for the known attacks for position verification, indeed, this left-hand side is zero. So essentially, all known attacks, the second round in the operations is indeed independent of epsilon. And also, this is a statement for the second round of operations, the tilde. There is a similar statement for the first operation. But I mean, in the first operation, the result is a bit more technical, and the norms one has to control are also more technical. So I will just comment on the result for the second round, but I mean, just there is another analog statement for the first round. So in a sense, if they want to break a position-based cryptography, either they use exponential resources or they need that both rounds, the first and the second, are highly non-regular with respect to small changes in the bit string. Good. Okay. So now let's go to the math techniques. And the key thing is that we will associate to each strategy a vector-valued map on the Boolean hypercube. And then we'll analyze the properties of that maps by some properties of the Banach space in which this map takes values, and in particular type and cotype constants. Okay. Let me recall, probably you already know that, but let me recall the notion of a type in a Banach space. So if we have a Banach space X, and again, in our case, will be always finite dimensional. I mean, the type two constant of X is the infimum of the constants T for which this inequality is true. So this inequality, I mean, upper bounds, an expectation value of the norm of some sum of elements in the Banach space with epsilon, which are just, I mean, Rademacher random variables, by the sum of the norm, some L2 norm here, vector value L2 norm. And this T must be uniform, on all possible sequences of elements. Okay, it's the infimum of all possible in which this happens. There is an analog inequality from the other side, and then the notion is cotype 2 instead of type 2. Okay. And if this sum that appears in this definition is restricted to have just m elements, then the type 2 constant now is the type 2 constant with m vectors, and it's t sub 2 over m x. The first thing to note is that this, in a sense, measures how far the Banach space is from a Hilbert space in some sense. So for instance, it's known since the 70s, I think it was Quapien who proved this, that essentially, if we have both bounds from above and below, let's say type 2 and cotype 2, then the only Banach space that fulfills this is the Hilbert space. I mean, essentially you are a Hilbert space up to small deformations. So now we are just looking at one side inequality. So in a sense, this measures how far you are from a Hilbert space in some one side way. It's very easy to see that a Hilbert space fulfills this with equality. We will do it just for the case of two vectors by the parallelogram law. This is true. And now if we rearrange, this is just saying that this expectation value is exactly equal to this sum. And therefore, the type 2 constant with two vectors of a Hilbert space is one. An exactly similar argument will show that indeed the type 2 constant of a Hilbert space is equal to one. Okay. So now the key thing we will consider are maps from the Boolean hypercube, say for a discrete set, the plus minus one to the m, into some Banach space X. And then we'll define a regularity parameter. Regularity parameter, okay, forget about the lock. I mean, in our case, we don't care about lock. And indeed, we put it here just by convenience. And what we have here is just the expectation value of the norm of the gradient of phi. So now phi takes place on a discrete set on the Boolean hypercube. So we define the partial derivative in the ith direction as simply just I change the value on the ith bit, take the difference, divide by two. So that's the way to define a discrete derivative. And then what I have here then is the norm of the gradient. So this is the expectation value of the norm of the gradient. And then you see that, okay, this is what appears at the right-hand side of a Sobolev-type inequality. So we are arriving slowly to Sobolev-type inequalities, okay? Good. So we call this regularity parameter. And then let's compute it just for, to make a small exercise to see how it behaves. We call it regularity parameter because if the map is very regular, then this is supposed to be small. First thing, of course, to notice is that if the map is constant, the derivatives are zero, and this regularity parameter is zero. So it's as small as it can be. So next example, next example will be linear map. A linear map is a map that is linear on epsilon. And then it's very easy if we do the computation of the derivatives and compute the regularity parameter that we get, okay, again, forget about the log term, we get 1 over n. Okay, so again, for linear maps, the parameter is very small, it's 1 over n. And essentially, we will be happy with anything of the form 1 over n to the alpha for any alpha bigger than 0. Okay, that's our sufficiently regular condition. Okay, good. And now, this is the key ingredient that we need. And that's a theorem proved by Pisier, which is a Sobolev-type inequality for vector-valued maps on the Boolean hypercube. And you see that this is a Sobolev-type thing in the sense that we have here assume that the mean is zero. So the left-hand side would be just the expectation value of some norm of phi. And on the right-hand side, we have the expectation value of the norm of the gradient, okay? So that's kind of the Sobolev-type inequality we will need. And indeed, what we will need is a corollary in which we mix this lemma with the notion of type 2. And indeed, and again, here you see maybe better the Sobolev-type thing. So we have that the expectation value of the norm is bounded by the norm of the expectation value. So imagine for a second that this is zero, that the vector valued map is symmetric and this is zero. And then we have that the expectation value of the norm of phi is bounded by some constant, the regularity parameter, which again is the expectation value of the gradient, and then another constant, which is the type 2 constant of the Banach space X. Okay, so the prefactor, forget about this norm of the expectation value, so that assume is zero for a second. So what the prefactor of this Sobolev-type inequality is just the type 2 constant of X. Okay, that's the thing. And that's the corollary we will need. Okay, so let's now prove our theorem. Now, the key thing is to find a nice way to map cheating strategies into vector-valued maps on the Boolean hypercube. Okay, and this is the particular one we define for the case of the second round of strategies. I think this should be a tilde here. But again, it doesn't matter. There is a way to define it. These are just the dual vectors, the vectors of the canonical base of the dual Hilbert space. I remind here that this corresponds to this, but the exact expression really doesn't matter. The thing is that there is a way, given a strategy, there is a way to define a map from the Boolean hypercube into some Banach space. And for the second, the bound on the second strategy, this Banach space is very simple. It's the set of matrices of size k squared with the operator norm. When we want to have a similar bound for the first strategy, this space is much more complicated. And then we have to work harder to prove type 2 constants and these things. But let's stick now to the simpler case. Why this is a smart way to define a vector valued map? And that's the key observation, that the expectation value of the norm of this map is an upper bound to the value of the game played by that strategy. Okay, that's the key observation. And that's why, one of the things this makes this a nice choice. Once we have this, we have then the connection between the two words, the world of the position-based cryptography, where we have this cheating strategy, this optimal cheating strategy, and all these things, this value here. I remind you that this is the best probability, I mean, the expected probability, sorry, of passing the challenge if they play with a strategy S. Okay, so that's what connects with position-based cryptography. And at the side of the inequality, this is just Banach space word. Okay, there is no position-based, it's just analysis here. So now we keep going with this part. Now, according to our corollary of Pisier, we can keep bounding, and we bound this by the other side of the Pisier bound, which is this. Okay, good. Now, first thing, we know exactly which is the type two constant of mk square. The type two constant is an upper bound of the type two constant with n square vectors, and the type two constant is order square root of log k. Of the space of matrix with the operator norm. So now this allows to bound this second part of the summand. As for the first part, we need of another lemma in which we can prove that this is bounded by 3/4 plus something of the order 1/√n. Now we put all the bounds together. And then we have that this value, essentially the probability of passing the game with a strategy S, is upper bounded by 3/4 plus C square root of log K, the regularity parameter associated to the strategy plus O 1/√n. So if we assume that the cheating strategy passes the challenge, so essentially the probability of passing the challenge is 1 minus some delta, and we solve in K, we solve that K must be exponential in 1/√n. Regularity parameter. And now we need just a final lemma which bounds the regularity parameter by the expression we wanted plus some order 1/√n. So you put everything together, we obtain the main result. Okay. Good. So let me just finish with some comments about unconditional bounds. So far, what we have shown is that cheaters, either they need exponential resources and then therefore they are out, or they need to cook up very non-regular strategies. And then, okay, they have to be smart enough for that if their strategies exist. But we believe that this second option is not really an option. So essentially we believe that indeed, even with very irregular strategies, they still need exponential entanglement. Okay, the thing is that for that we need to deal with more complicated Banach spaces. So we saw that in order to prove the result under this using this regularity hypothesis, the Banach space for which we have to control the type two constant is very easy. It's the space of matrices with operator norm, at least for the second strategy. If we want an analog result for the first strategy, we need a more complicated Banach space, but still for that we were able to compute the type two constant. But if we want to forget about these regularity assumptions, we have to deal with a Banach space, which is a bit of a monster. And this is it. Okay, there are several ones that will work. This is one particular one. So we have tensor product of Hilbert spaces. So L to N, just complex Hilbert space of dimension N. And we tensorize with itself, but in which we include particular tensor norms. And in particular, 3 of the 14 tensor norms that were defined by Grothendieck and called by Grothendieck natural tensor norms, which are the pi, the epsilon, and the g2. Okay, and they correspond to the there is a duality between tensor norms and operator ideals, and they are related to the operator ideals of nuclear bounding and two summing operators, respectively. Okay. Good. And then, okay, we also have a way to relate and a strategy to a vector valued map with values in this space. And now the bound we get is exactly this. And then you see that there are no regularity parameters anymore. So it's just some dependencies on N and the type two constant of this object. So our conjecture is that this object has a type two constant that is N to the beta for some beta strictly less than one and some polylog factors in k, let's say log k, square root of log k, something like that. If this conjecture is true, then this implies that K must be exponential in N, even without any regularity assumptions. Okay. So why we believe this conjecture is true? Which are okay, we have several evidences in this direction, but I think the most relevant one is we compute the volume ratio of the dual space. So the volume ratio is the quotient between the volume of the unit ball of this dual space and the volume of the largest ellipsoid contained in that ball. Okay, and we computed it, and it's n to the 3/4. And now it's a long open problem since the 70s, 80s, whether for tensor products of LP spaces, which are Banach spaces with a lot of symmetries, whether there is a connection between the type 2 constant of one Banach space and the volume ratio of the dual. And indeed, all known examples, these two quantities deviate at most in log factors. Okay. But I must say that for even for the simplest case of three copies of L2 with the epsilon or pi norm, it's a question that was posed by Pisier already in the beginning of the 80s or end of the 70s, this is still not known. So the volume ratio is known, and the type 2 constant for the case of the epsilon is not known at all. I mean, indeed, there's a huge gap between the two. So it's a hard question. But I mean, so far, this is all we can say. So let me just conclude with a couple of final remarks. So first result is that our main theory implies previous bounds on other things which are relevant, which are called programmable quantum processors. So essentially, this is if you have a universal quantum computer, and you, if it's universal, you want that it's able to run any program and produce any desired quantum evolution. One may ask which is the dimension of the program space so that it's able to simulate an arbitrary quantum evolution. And then we showed that in this dimension of the program space must be exponential on the dimension of the evolution the quantum computer wants to simulate. And this, indeed, the results here imply all those results. And second, there is a recent connection, which is very intriguing, with quantum gravity. Okay. And I don't understand it at all. But there is a claim by people, physicists, very good physicists from a Stanford group, in which using physics-like reasoning related to some properties that they are expected for a good holographic correspondence between essentially what is called ADS-CFT duality, some models of quantum gravity. In principle, they claim that if this holographic correspondence have all the properties that they are expected to have, and these again are physics-like arguments of string theory, then position-based cryptography, position verification, could be broken with K, which is only polynomial in N. And this contradicts our result and our conjecture. Okay. So question is, are there any implications of our results, of our techniques of function analysis in this holographic duality models of quantum gravity? Let's say, blind think. Maybe they imply that these duality maps must be highly non-regular, for instance, if they exist or things like that. But this is something definitely for future work, because at this moment we don't understand this connection. We are lacking the expertise on this quantum gravity. And with that, I finish my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, David. Are there questions for our speaker? You can either type or ask directly.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. I just got curious about the last thing, because did you say that the physicists have a counterexample to your theorem, or your theorem is a counterexample to the result?
Our theorem,
Can you elaborate on that?
Our theorem, I think, is correct, because it's a mathematical statement. That's it. Okay, you never know if there is a gap in the proof, but we think there is no gap in the proof. Their statement is not a mathematical statement. It's a physics-like statement based on things that are believed to happen in some holographic correspondences that are believed to be true. And the arguments are very physics-like. I mean, really like, I mean, this amount of thing could not, by perturbation theory, make some things. And I mean, this holographic duality is a duality in which in the bulk you have quantum, you have gravity, and in the boundary you have a conformal field theory.
Yeah.
These are these Maldacena-Witten results. And okay, there are some rigorous results for some particular examples, but there are some believed results that hold in generality. And this is the type of arguments they use. So my hope is that since our arguments are rigorous, maybe these have some implications on some rigorous claims about this holographic correspondence, whatever they are. For instance, that they cannot be regular, let's say, something like that. But before doing any claim, I have to really understand the connection that I don't understand at all. I mean, simply just future work.
One of these things which were believed, they were believed, but they were wrong. Or they are true only under certain assumptions. And just a second question, just to see whether I grasp what you were doing. So you were showing a strategy that cannot be cheat, right?
Yes.
But could you sort of characterize why the, or I mean, it makes sense to ask, okay, so this strategy cannot be cheat, but it cannot be cheat because, as you were saying, it's very asymmetric. So if the strategy would be more asymmetric, then this space of an entanglement would have a lower dimension. Does this question make sense at all or not?
Yes. Indeed, we have also results that, I mean, in which we have also results in which the, let me go back to the strategy part. So that's the type of strategy. It's very asymmetric. So these are classical bits. This is quantum information. So we have also results in a total symmetric scenario in which there is no classical information going on. Everything is quantum. And for that, we have really also identified a Banach space for which we want to compute the type two constant of a particular, okay, not the type constant, I mean, some expectation value of some particular thing. First thing is that now this Banach space indeed is not a Banach space, it's an operator space. And in order to define it, we need operator space concepts. And second is, despite looking innocent, it's highly non-innocent. So for instance, it's a Banach space that has a subspace, a complemented subspace, for which computing the norm is known to be undecidable. And indeed this complemented Banach space is exactly the one that, if you understand what you need to compute this norm and why it's undecidable, this gave rise to the recent solution of the cone embedding problem. So essentially, indeed, the way the recent these computer scientists disproved the cone embedding problem was to show indeed that computing, approximating this norm to a constant precision is undecidable, and this implies the cone embedding conjecture is false. And our space has this subspace as complemented subspace. So in the end, it's even more complex than that. So even if it looks innocent, it's not innocent at all. I mean, this tensor, Banach tensor spaces, they look innocent, but they are a monster. I mean, really a monster. So yeah, I mean, maybe this explains why essentially there has been no progress on the problem since 10 years. I mean, up to our approach here, which gives new maths in the two, I mean, mathematical tools.
Yeah.
There was no progress at all in the question. Nothing. Maybe this explains why, because this is very related to these Banach spaces, which are really monsters. Even if they look innocent, they are not innocent at all. I mean, these spaces are monsters.
Okay, so in a nutshell, your new improvement is to bring this analysis viewpoint whatever putting in the title is sort of inequalities type of way of thinking, even if they are much more complicated in the game. Yes. Very nice. Okay, thank you.
More questions? I have one of mine. So can you go back to the place where you use PCS inequality?
Definitely. Here?
It really doesn't matter. So this smoothness sigma depends on the dimension, right? Because the constant in PCS inequality cannot be
This is the definition, say, if you want, yes.
Right. This is because Pisier's inequality cannot be, the log term cannot be removed there, right?
No, I mean, in principle, I think it can under also some type.
Under assumptions, yes, but there are Banach spaces for which this cannot be removed.
Yes.
And this gives you a quantitative thing there that you have to account for. Yes. So if one were able to improve that bound, would one get something new, something?
No, the best one can hope for is to remove this log term, but log terms we don't care about, really, we don't care. I mean, log terms.
So even if one could improve that wouldn't.
No, for us, it wouldn't be any. Indeed, we could have used some, I mean, recent work, but I think last year or something, in which they improved Pisier without the log term, but we could also use that.
That's what I was thinking of. Yeah, this is a result by Volberg and collaborators. Yes.
Exactly. But
they average in a different way and they get a different Poincaré inequality and then the log is not there. Yes.
But the log is not a problem for us. As I said, I always neglected log factors here because log is not a problem for us.
So it doesn't really matter. Okay. Thank you. We thank David again. Thank you very much.
Thank you.